as I was reflecting on the content that I wanted to share with you today, it really dawned on me, you know, I think this is the most important episode I've done so far. So stick with me. I think you're going to get a lot out of this. Hi, welcome back to Your Money Mindset, guiding you to achieve lasting financial freedom and peace of mind. I'm John McGregor. I wanted to start with a question that I want you to ask yourself. You know, I've been asking this question to a lot of people and it's been really kind of wakening people up. The question is, what does financial freedom and peace of mind mean to you? It's interesting. Financial peace of mind is something everyone is striving for. Everybody on this planet wants, and yet very few people have taken the time to really think about what their life would be like if they had financial peace of mind. So I want you to actually pause this video and take some time, 30 seconds, 30 minutes, whatever it is, and I want you to really visualize and get to a granular level of what financial peace of mind means to you and your family. So go ahead and do that, hit the pause button, and we'll see you when you come back. Welcome back. So how was that? Was that enlightening? Did it open up any new windows in your life? Did you think differently at all? Did it kind of change your perspective on where you're at versus where you want to be? I want you to continue with this exercise. Keep doing it, because really the more you visualize what financial peace of mind means to you, the more likely you're going to achieve that. And keep thinking that. Keep putting those thoughts, those visuals in your mind as you go forward. For me, financial peace of mind meant really living life on my own terms. I didn't want to work for a paycheck. I didn't want to rely on somebody or a company to take care of me. I wanted to be in charge. I wanted to be in financial control of my own life. What really hit me between the eyes, it was a transformative moment. Thank goodness I had it, and I was very fortunate to have experienced this. I was 20 years old, landscaping, which really is a fancy term for mowing yards and pulling weeds, and boy, I've had some horrible jobs when I look back. So I was landscaping in Hawaii, where I'm originally from, and I was going to school on the side, and my boss, Larry, who's still mowing yards to this day, great guy, we were at my favorite house that I just loved to work on. It was this gorgeous estate in Hawaii, and it overlooked the ocean, and it just had this amazing backyard with the pool and the waterfall and the jacuzzi, and it was just a gorgeous, straight out of a magazine. And finally, after doing this house several occasions, I finally asked Larry, I said, Larry, how do these people afford this house? What do they do for a living? And he looked at me and he said, John, do you really want what they have? I said, yeah, of course. He says, do you really? And I said, yeah, of course. That's why I'm out here in the 90 degree weather pushing a lawnmower and going to school inside. He said, I'll never forget this. Do yourself a favor. He didn't say do me a favor. He said, John, do yourself a favor. Walk up the stairs and look in the kitchen window and tell me what you see. I said, are you crazy? He said, don't worry. No one's home. So I did what he told me, and I crossed the lawn and I walked up the stairs and I peeked my head in the kitchen window, and it was amazing to me. All I saw were a couple of paper plates on the counter and a coffee pot on the stove. That was it. And in the corner, you could see the living room from this window as well. And there was a what we call a futon. It's a small bed on the ground with a blanket crumpled up in the corner. It's like they hadn't moved in. It was really strange. So I went back to Larry. I said, what gives? Did they just move in? He said, no. They've been here for 2 years. He said, the reason you didn't see anything in there is because they're flat broke. I said, flat broke? He said, yeah, the husband had a very high-paying political job, but his candidate that he was supporting got in some trouble and got fired. And his wife was an up-and-coming realtor, and then she suddenly came down with cancer. He said the problem was they were spending money like they already had it. They were leveraged up to the tilt, a couple of mortgages on their home, maxed out on credit card bills. They had nothing. And he said, John, you'd be surprised how many houses we work on, how many beautiful houses we work on with really nice cars in the driveway. How many of them are one paycheck away from going bankrupt and losing it all? And my eyes just blew wide open. I couldn't believe what he was telling me. He said, John, the problem is most people are living a life of a facade. It's not really who they are. They're just pretending to be somebody they're not to impress others. And that's when he said to me, he said, John, so many people are just trying to keep up with the Joneses. We've all heard that term. But then he added, the problem is the Joneses are broke as well. It was that moment that I made the commitment to myself that I would never put myself in that position. I set a goal for myself that I wanted to be financially independent by the time I was 40. Now, looking back, I was fortunate enough. I worked really hard. I sacrificed a lot. I hit my goal at 37. And yeah, it required a lot of sacrifice, a lot of stuff I wanted to do, and a lot of things that I wanted to buy, I didn't. I didn't fall for that trap. And thankfully, I was able to become financially free and independent at age 37. And that's been just an incredible game changer for me and my life. And it's enabled me to do so many things. And I want to pass on this knowledge, how I did it, so you can do it too. And you can do it no matter how old you are. I don't care if you're in the 60s or 70s, it does not matter. I've worked with thousands of individuals over the past 26 years helping them. And I've seen people in their 60s and 70s pull themselves out of some pretty dire situations. Now, I will say, the younger you are, better opportunities you have, and it's a little easier for you. But again, it is never too late to start your journey to financial freedom and peace of mind. If you have the right mindset and the right process in place, anyone can do this. And this is what I want to help you do. The hardest conversations I've had to have with people is when they came into my office at age 65 or something like that, and they said, John, I'm ready to retire. I've worked 30 to 40 years, and now it's time for me to enjoy my golden years. And they lay out their financials, and I can just tell immediately they're not ready to retire, and they certainly can't retire in the lifestyle that I'd always envisioned for themselves. And I have to tell them that they have to continue working. It's extremely painful for both of us. And I don't want that to happen to you. Again, with the right mindset and the right process in place, you can achieve financial peace of mind. I'm going to give you a couple of things to do. And by the way, this is not about getting rich. You don't need millions of dollars for financial peace of mind. I will tell you, I know a lot of very, very wealthy, rich people that are absolutely miserable. So there's no direct correlation between being a multimillionaire and having financial peace of mind. It's all about changing your mindset and having a better relationship with money. So you're not using money to dull your pain. You're using money to fulfill your purpose. That's the difference. That's the paradigm shift in anything else you've seen or read. It's about having that relationship with money that furthers yourself in life so you can achieve those goals and those dreams that not only you desire, but you deserve for you and your family. And why is this so important? Well, I will tell you, this is a matter of life or death. Now, I know you may be thinking, hey, John, that's a little overboard, but it's not. Just hear me out. Any research you look at will tell you that money is the number one cause of stress in society. And stress is the number one cause of our most deadly diseases and health ailments. Stress causes insomnia, heart problems, lung issues, cirrhosis, suicide, high blood pressure, insomnia, irritability, anxiousness. I mean, you go down the list, 75% of physician office visits are stress related. Please look it up. I am not kidding. Stress is the number one cause of our health ailments. So if money is the number one cause of stress, and stress is the number one cause of all of these health ailments, there's a direct correlation between the two. That's why I say I think sometimes I'm in the health industry, not the financial industry. This is a bigger epidemic than all diseases combined. When you think about 78% of the population is living paycheck to paycheck, and about 64-65% of people could not come up with $400 for an emergency expense. That means people are suffering out there. And the problem with financial stress is different than regular stress. Regular stress comes and goes. You're fighting traffic, you're rushing to an appointment, you're on your first date. Those stresses come and go. Financial stress is what we call prolonged stress. It doesn't stop. It's with you 24/7. And unfortunately, our bodies are not designed for prolonged stress. That's why it breaks our body down at a cellular level. That's why it leads to so many health ailments. Think about insomnia, which I think I mentioned twice already. Just not being able to sleep as a result of your financial struggles actually lowers your IQ. Think of what lack of sleep does to your overall life and your relationships. Not to mention, money problems are the number one cause of the divorce. So I hope now you can understand why I say this is such a massive, massive problem, and it is a life or death issue. That's why it's so important to get your financial house in order, and that's what I want to help you do. So here are some practical steps that I want to share with you. And you all know these, but I just want to reinforce their importance and why you have to take these steps now. The first step is I want you to get financially organized. In my experience, in the years of working with people, I clearly have seen there is a direct correlation between financial disorganization and financial devastation. If you can get yourself financially organized, that is a huge step in the direction, in your direction towards financial peace of mind. Too many times clients come into my office with what I call a shoebox or a junk drawer, just full of statements and documents and contracts. You might be smiling right now because you're in the same situation. The more financially organized you are, the more you're setting yourself up for success. There's a document on my website that you can download that helps show you how to get financially organized. Getting financially organized, getting your paperwork in order would be a huge step in peace of mind. And given what's going on, we could all use a lot of peace of mind right now. Number two is budget. Now I know we hate that word. It's like exercise, right? But it is absolutely critical that you make this part of your routine on a weekly or monthly basis. And I know it's not fun, but it is absolutely critical. If you're not managing your money or monitoring your money or watching where your money is going, you're just winging it and leaving too many things to chance. And you're going to be another one of those individuals that comes into my office or another financial advisor's office at 65 and says, I want to retire, but you can't. And a lot of it was because you didn't manage your cash flow. So what I want you to do is go back. And if you have a spouse or a partner, please do this together. It's so important that you guys are on the same page. I want you to look back at all your expenditures over the last 3 months, all of them. Go to your credit card bills, your checking account, think of all the money you spent with cash, and really list them out. And then I want you to categorize them by needs and wants. Now, I'm not picking on wants. We all love to do things and have fun and enjoy life. But a lot of times when you do this, you will see a significant imbalance between needs and wants, and that needs to be addressed. And just by looking at all your expenditures, it could be a huge aha moment, an awareness moment that you weren't even aware of the money that you were spending. And this could immediately increase your cash flow. Now, once you look at your needs versus your wants, try to balance them out. I want you to look at each one of those expenditures and ask yourself, was there a cheaper or more economical way to have that need or that want? And I will tell you, in most cases, you can find cheaper ways to fulfill your needs and your wants. And again, that will increase cash flow immediately. Okay, the third is I want you to pay yourself. What I mean by this is the amount of money coming in from your paycheck or wherever it's coming from, I want you to automatically set aside a percentage that automatically sweeps into another account to be invested and not to be touched. That is in a vault, not to be touched. Now you ask, how much should you be putting away? Well, in a perfect world, I want to see people put away 20% of their take-home pay. I know you're probably looking at me like I have two heads. John, furloughed, I'm laid off, commissions aren't coming in, I don't have a paycheck anymore. I get it. That 20% is an ideal scenario. Now, for those younger people, the millennials, the Gen Xers, and the Gen Zers, and whatever else they call them now, is starting out, yes, you should definitely start with 20% paying yourself and building that nest egg immediately. It'll be a lot easier starting out than if you're in your 40s or 50s. So for those that can't do 20% in the time right now, start with 1%. And then set a goal that every 3 months or every 6 months, you're going to increase that by 1%. So it's not as painful to you. But it's so important that you set it up automatically, this savings program, into an investment that grows over time. You'll be amazed how much money you can accumulate fairly quickly. The fourth thing I want you to do is goal set. Goal setting is what I talked to you about earlier in my life. When at age 20, I set my goal that I wanted to be financially free at age 40. If you don't have goals, you're just basically shooting arrows in the sky, hoping something hits. And you're just, again, leaving too many things to chance. I want you to set 3, 6, 1, 5, 10, 20 year goals out. And I want you to revisit these goals on a regular basis. If you just write them down once and forget about it and never look at them again, it's just a waste of time. Your goals, your financial goals should be laid out and accessible and visible all the time. So you're constantly reminding yourself, constantly reminding your subconscious, which is where all your life is, your activities and your behaviors sit in your subconscious. By reminding yourself of your goals on a regular basis, again, that is a huge, huge step in financial peace of mind and freedom. So got the four: organize, budget, pay yourself, and goal set. Get started now, please. I want to help you. I want to see you succeed in life financially and really enjoy your life as you set out to become and be and enjoy those years when you're no longer, or even now. So with that, I hope this was helpful, and I hope you got something out of this. And I hope you can understand how important this is, and keep reminding yourself, keep thinking about what financial peace of mind means to you. And again, that's just another way to solidify and codify that visual that you want and you deserve for your life. So with that, as I always say, it's never too late to start your journey to financial freedom and peace of mind. Your financial destiny is not a matter of chance. It's a matter of choice, and it's not something to be waited for. It's something that you need to go out and get, and you can get it. Hit the subscribe button, and also please leave me a message or a comment. I'd love to hear from you. So with that, we'll see you next time. Take care.